My wife is asking me if I'm okay because of the amount of yelling that I'm doing.
You're listening to littlepodcast.com.
I definitely did that in college. I think the statute of limitations has expired. And what does pig medicine smell like? Hey man, we gotta kick a Mountain Dew ice.
I'm on the Mountain Dew wiki, so I know I'm in the right place. Hey, you know, this thing sounds good, but at least this motherfucker never broke in the middle of a fucking call. Welcome to Born the 80s. Episode 334. I am your delightful and capable host, Jonathan Dangerow, joined by my co-hosts.
Matt Haig, and I'm joined by my co-host.
Crumply Paper, TJ May.
Okay.
And we just get
that's
some...
my anime news alert noise.
Hang on.
There it is. So I was just talking about this the other day, I think, with
sub-average penises.
I was talking about this to my brother. So I have the Neon Genesis Evangelion Perfect Collection DVDs, 2002, the box set. Let me see if I have it in my hands so I can wave my monetary peen in front of everyone.
Yeah. Well, watch out. Okay. You're not going to be able to.
It's not in this
withstand
box.
Withstand the flood of pussy that comes at you if you show that off.
So let's say a used, very good quality box set of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 DVDs is $400.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Mm-hmm.
Because they've been out of publishing for years.
Until now.
Who's got the rights?
The rights are now owned by Netflix.
What?
Neon Genesis Evangelion, the original 26 episodes of the 1995 anime, along with the two films, End of Evangelion, which I have, sells alone as a single DVD for $100, because they made zero copies of it, will be made, as well as the other Death True 2, which is like a little short film thing, which is...
So what you're saying is they're both repressing. They're doing more DVDs.
Well, okay. I'm just saying I don't really know what's happening, but because there's very little news. This literally broke 7 minutes ago. Neon Genesis, they put a trailer up on YouTube. It says official trailer HD Netflix, and I'm just going to watch this 1 minute trailer.
Okay.
And it looks like they've remastered it in HD because this looks so much better than the DVD copies that I have. Like, because the DVDs are not great. And if... I was talking about how, like, I cannot believe this anime is not available. Because it's probably, like, one of the most influential animes of all
time. Other than Akira, it's the classic.
Yeah, I mean, it's the anime that was like, hey, here's giant robots, but it's also about fucked up kids, which is, like, 90% of animes. Mm-hmm. It's about fucked up children having to do, like, adult stuff.
At the end of the day, aren't we all fucked up children?
Mm-hmm.
Every single one of us.
There are no
child
adults.
Soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
Fucked up experiments. Like, gore. I don't know. It's like the anime that exists now. It was like, I mean, it's 95. You know, it's really... Not to mention, I'm going to fucking fanboy out. It has some of the best music ever in any form of entertainment. Like... Some of the original compositions in this are just so good. And it looks amazing. And just to have it in HD is good. Because they've been redoing the movies.
Because
they're doing like... They're doing like a retelling. Like a reboot, basically. With movies that are coming out in Japan. And those have been good, but it's not the same. I mean, they got most of the same voice actors. So it's okay, but they didn't get the original Akari back, and I like that guy's voice who did that. I mean, it's crazy because I was just talking about this. I was like, who owns the rights to this? Because we looked it up a couple, maybe 20 or 30 episodes back, and it was ADV is not a company anymore. They're the ones that did the dub. And then, I was like, who owns it? And I guess it reverted back to the parent company in Japan. So there's like no distributor outside of Japan for this. And so it looks like they got the rights. Although it doesn't say that it's... There's no audio of the voices in this. But it does sound like it's the original.
Let's like, that aired, listen so. To it. Right.
I like how you're playing this. No. I was about to say, I don't think the audio is very good. Because it's not any audio from the anime.
It's just some it's drums.
Like, it's
some
like
of
a
those cool drums. Like when they have the Olympics over there.
I just want to mention that this does not have any audio from the series.
Oh, yeah. Listen to that. Everybody's favorite song that you all remember.
Yes, this is not a song from the
Imagine
soundtrack.
The pictures.
Netflix so tends great. To do that with everything.
Yeah, they really do. They use, like, canned audio.
They're
but it's
like,
coming
nobody knows
in
this
spring
shit.
2019, so... Wow. Sorry. That's just, like, immediate breaking news that is, like, relevant directly to my fandom.
To your fandom and your Gundam.
Okay, this Kotaku article is not strong. I would like to see if what people are saying. Here's immediate questions that all nerds have to say. Is this HD remaster? Who's licensing this? Is the director's cuts that are going to be added? Why is there not a Blu-ray set available of this? Like, what the fuck? Yeah, so. Let me just go to the Evangelion Reddit from July. Whereas a petition to request Netflix to pick up Evangelion.
And now is everybody celebrating? Like, we did it.
We're
so powerful.
Let me switch the comments not to best, but to...
sort by controversial.
It? Sort by new. Done. Oh, this is someone saying that they did it. Yeah, there's nobody saying that. I'm going to just reply to this.
TJ, I think somebody in the chat's saying they want to have sex with you.
Yeah, close enough.
Alright, that's it. I just had to say holy crap they did it because...
Oh, Cruddy Kid in the chat says, when is this going to be in the IMAX theater?
This is so insane.
Do they ever do theatrical re-releases of anime like this?
In the US?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Miyazaki movies get theatrical releases in the U.S. Those were licensed by Disney, though, originally. They're not anymore.
Mm.
But I think that was part of it. But this is insane. It's insane that they have the movie, too, because the end of Evangelion... Because the series kind of has an ending that's not a real ending. Because if I remember correctly, listening to them talk about the production, they just ran out of money to make the ending that they wanted, but then the show was popular enough that they were able to come back later and redo the ending. It's just great. Yeah. Here's the thing. This guy's saying, yes, I've been waiting for the longest time to have this available. Finally, I'll be able to share Evangelion with all my friends. I don't know if this is an anime for sharing. It's pretty fucked up. Like, but it is really good. Like, Lance Kilcoyne, you know, you guys know Lance?
Never heard of him.
The Lance man has been on this podcast. He's not into a lot of animes, but he loved Evangelion. So, what can I say? It's because it's so fucking crazy. Like, there's alien creatures attacking and blown up cities, and there's good music and explosions. I don't know. It's good. So, it's crazy.
Yeah, it's one of those that, like, even as a non-anime watcher growing up, I was definitely aware of.
Yeah, there's a lot of memes
everywhere.
Yeah, but okay, so nobody, this is like literally just been announced, so there's like no.
So we'll have to watch that together right after we finish watching Cowboy Bebop.
Oh, hey, FYI about Cowboy Bebop. I bought all of it. I bought, because I already have the DVDs, and that's how we were watching it, Matt, I bought them on Amazon. Like digital streaming.
Oh, okay.
Well, because
the ones you had were like weird TV rips or something, right?
No. I had the actual physical DVDs.
Oh, yeah. But I thought it was something where like they didn't have the masters anymore, so they just had like You were telling me they can't do like an HD remaster of it because they don't have the originals or anything.
Correct, because a lot of that was done, not that per se, which is what I thought might be the same for Evangelion, which is why I'm confused, because the trailer definitely looks to be HD remastered, but maybe they just did a little bit.
Well, it depends on how much money you want to spend, too. You can always just redo textures on top of it if you want to up-res it.
I'm just wondering if they're going to fuck it up and make it widescreen. I'm going to watch this trailer again. Oh, it's not. It's 4x3 in the trailer. Fuck, yes. God, I hate places that do that shit. Like, if you try and... yeah. Oh, man, I could rant about this for hours. Like, because, like, the FXX now has, like, every Simpsons streaming. If you have a, like, cable subscription and you can log into the FX website, you can watch any Simpsons episode. But they're all 16x9.
Yeah.
And it's like, why
when my parents
fuck
got a
this?
Widescreen TV, they always had it on the setting where it like stretched to the sides out, and I was just like, how can you watch this shit?
It looks bad.
It's bad.
It's not the original way it was meant to be done. And then but anyway. So anyway, the trailer looks to be 4x3. Honestly, like the worst part about like I could talk about this forever. So I'm going to cut myself off in about 2 minutes here. But like the worst part about this is the DVDs that I've ripped off of are not very high quality. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of frame judder because the transfer isn't very good. And it's even evident if you put the DVD in a player, the images are kind of shaky in it because it's just not well made. I think that the other DVDs that they put, because they put another set out in the mid-2000s. The set I have is from 2002, which is the original US DVD release.
Basically the Dark Ages.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, I originally watched Neon Genesis Evangelion from VHS tapes back in the day. But then I got the DVDs because it was $60 for that DVD box set, which is now $400. I mean, it's insane the price, because they just stopped making it and everyone collected it. Because you can't watch it anywhere. But now Netflix, that's really cool. That's good. Netflix has been pushing hard with the animes, though. You know? They got that Castlevania anime. Yeah. Well, it's been mostly original stuff, though. So.
Yeah.
But I think this is a big get, because, like TJ said, there's like Akira, which is the anime everyone's watched from the mid-90s, and then there's this.
Yeah. That's interesting, though, because like all of Netflix's decisions are data-driven based on what people are looking up, so that must mean there's a pretty big market for anime.
I mean, I think that if you're someone who subscribes to like Crunchyroll and stuff, and then someone's like, oh, hey, remember Evangelion, the show that you remember and enjoyed watching VHS tapes of, but now cannot get copies of except for illegal ones? Hey, guess what? You can just watch it on your phone from Netflix now. Mm-hmm. Boom. People are going to subscribe. Like,
I bet
they'll get people.
Crunchyroll shitting their pants a little bit, because if Netflix decides they want to go full into the anime game, they'll
eat. I guess you're
lunch.
Right. That's true, yeah. I suppose. But I guess at least the thing Crunchyroll has going for it, and their sister site Creamy Roll. That's not an original joke. I stole that from Vice Gaming.
Yeah,
they made that joke, which I like. When you say Creamy Roll, it sounds so bad. No, but Crunchyroll, they focus mostly on live like shows and not dubs.
Shit, that's, like,
so it's mostly stuff
airing.
That's like. It like simulcast, like it airs in Japan at the same time, so they're probably a little bit safer. And then Funimation's probably fine too, because they have all of their Funimation licensed stuff, which is a large portion of anime that's been dubbed.
I mean, at this point, you know, all of the stuff that were kind of back catalog that we hadn't gotten from Japan has already gone over, so everyone is super competitive over getting the new stuff.
Yeah,
and then. Mm-hmm. It's just those lingering licenses that are going to...
Yeah, there's weird stuff. I mean, there's a lot of stuff from the 90s and 80s that I haven't seen on a lot of streaming services. Like, is Bubblegum Crisis anywhere? Because I think that was also ADV.
That's a fantastic
Ninja Scroll
name.
Was ADV. There's a lot of stuff that was done by ADV, which was like, there was Funimation, which is the Dragon Ball company, and then there was ADV, which did a lot of animes. That company doesn't exist anymore, and their like rights for those shows basically kind of went to whoever had them, and some were probably bought by companies that were like Helsing, I think, had an ADV dub that was bought But then they redid.
Aniplex, are they still around?
Yeah, but I think Aniplex is newer, and they bought a bunch of old stuff. Gotcha. I don't really know how all this works. All I know is that the licensing for Neon Genesis Evangelion disappeared, and the Japanese were not interested in shopping it around, I guess, until now. And I'm sure Netflix was like, "Hey, we can handle all this. You just gotta give us the rights, and we'll pay you." And they're like,
"Sure." The real question is how popular Netflix is in Japan, because maybe they got some clout.
Yeah, that's
a thought. That's a thought. I don't really know.
I also wonder if there's like some mega popular streaming service over there that we just don't know about at all.
I know, right?
I'm sure there are.
Because that's always the thing with Netflix trying to acquire stuff, whether there's like regional companies that we just don't know about that already have like a stranglehold on it.
I'm sure some of the actual broadcast stations, like their TBS, Tokyo Broadcasting System, and whatnot, that have their own personal streaming services.
Oh, wow.
Or whatever they own.
Netflix launched in Japan. Here's... Well, this is just a statistics portal. I don't know where this data is coming from. Okay, it says I need to have a premium account to see where the data came from. Well, according to this bullshit thing that might be... It says in 2014, there were zero subscribers to Netflix in Japan. So they must have launched in 2015. They had 500,000. Right now there's 2.65 million in Japan.
Okay.
So it's grown quite a bit in 2 years. So I think it maybe it's probably part of it with the anime as well. It's like, hey, Japan's a big... I mean, Japanese people love their media.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's why you have anime, you have Japanese dramas, you have... You know, so, I mean, Netflix has got to jump in. Anyway, it's just exciting. Like, I was literally talking about this, like, Saturday. I was like, it's crazy that these DVDs I have are worth $400 because you can't get anywhere else. And I was like, I gotta sell them now. Before, because they're gonna go to nothing. Because I'm sure there'll be DVD releases or something. I wonder how that works with Netflix for rare stuff. Because, like, if I could... Do you think I could go on Netflix and get the DVD subscription? And then get a copy of, like, the Evangelion DVD series, episode 1. And then just, what if I didn't return it?
I would guess.
Do they charge you market value or, like, what the initial cost was? Because you could make a killing.
I think they just have a standard fee for all DVDs, regardless of what
it is. That's pretty insane. Because, like we've seen with some of these old movies, those DVDs are hard to come by.
Mm-hmm.
It may just be that they have, like, no copies of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It might just not be available.
So. And it's been a while since I've gotten any Netflix DVDs, but I seem to remember they had their own, like, DVD publishing arm. So you would get something, and it would say, like, this is a Netflix DVD.
Oh, yeah.
Where it would just be the movie, and it wouldn't have, like, special features or anything
Well, that's how rental places work, too. There's rental versions of DVDs.
Not that I'm advocating this, but you could, if you wanted to, subscribe to the Netflix DVD and then get the DVDs and then rip them onto your computer and then return them.
You could. Probably easier to just rip it straight from the streaming service. I don't know how to do that, but I'm sure it's possible.
Well,
the
encoding on that would be pretty bad, I think.
The problem with that is that costs money.
Well, you go to a library and do it too.
There we go. Thank you.
Yeah. I've done that.
Yeah.
Theoretically, but that's illegal, so I've not done
hypothetically,
it.
Yeah, of course, I don't do it either.
I definitely did that in Avatar college. I think the statute of limitations has expired, so I can admit that I rented movies from the college library and copied them.
Yeah. Oh, I actually have lots of those on the DVD case.
Yeah,
I
like
the
that
IT
sweet
department.
Binder that everyone had. That's fucking awesome.
Well, so if you worked at the IT department at Edgewood, they just had a DVD burner.
Yep.
Like a DVD copier, and you could put some movies in and it would just copy them if they didn't have protection on them. So we would just go over to like the movies at the library and just be like, "Oh, I kind of want to watch this," and I just put it in I borrowed like a friend's Simpsons DVDs and I was just like, "Boop, copy." Which is like it's theft, obviously. You know, it's illegal, but, like, also, you know, it's weird because it's, like, not like being distributed, it was just personal use. It's like a, it's like a, it's
the
like when you would VHS
like
tape stuff
unavailable,
you know?
Anywhere else. I'd never felt guilty about pirating.
Oh yeah, that's just like it, with even
like
Galleon.
With old games and stuff too.
Oh
if
yeah,
it was something that was just never released on an emulator.
Well, I don't think I had those morals back in college, but like now I have like the idea of if I can buy it or rent it, then I should.
Yeah.
You know, or if I can go to the library and pick it up, I should do it that way and not steal. But if you're going to not release a version of this I can obtain, then it's your own fault that I'm pirating this. Like Evangelion, if you wanted to watch that, the only way to watch it was to illegally download it or pay some asshole $400 for their DVDs. Like, that's bullshit. Like, anyway. But, oh my god, we talk about Nintendo settling with the ROM website?
Yeah.
Oh, I hadn't heard about that.
Oh, it was bad.
Well, okay.
Really bad.
So, I've learned a couple of things about this as well. So, we'll get into this. So, this was... Nintendo had settled with the operators of loveroms.com and loveretro.co. They reached a proposed settlement of $12.2 million.
Yeah.
That they're going to pay Nintendo.
This was Guy and his wife. Just two individuals.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's a couple interesting things about this. So I guess the way that civil settlements work is you can get a judgment for amount, but if the people aren't going to pay you that much, you don't have to like put them in collect, you know, they're not forced to pay you. So what a lot of analysts are saying, because like the people that run these retro websites don't have $12.2 million. You know, these were like hobby websites that
they
were running. You know, they weren't making money off these ads really. So a lot of people are saying this is probably just a very large symbolic amount of what damage they're estimating it would have done to the company. Like they lost this money because, you know, and to Nintendo's credit, they, you know, there were ROMs, and some of the more popular ROMs were games that you could get on the Virtual Console, you know, like the, all the, like a lot of those, Game Boy, Pokemon games were pretty popular on the ROM websites, and you can get that, you know, on your 3DS. So if you're pirating it, you know, that's $8 they're not getting or whatever. So anyway, they have reached a proposed settlement for $12.2 million. A judge has not yet signed the settlement, so I guess it'll be possible this doesn't happen. But it does sound like it's going to probably be, well, they're going to pay what they can. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So
I think a lot of time, like stuff like this is just to have a legal record of what Nintendo values this as, so that prevents other actual companies from coming in and being like, oh, well, you said in this other settlement that it was only worth a couple hundred dollars, so we can get away with it.
Exactly. They have to put up a large amount.
Yeah.
Because they need to calculate the actual monetary damages that I think these websites do. And then, of course, Emu Paradise also announced a while ago that it would no longer offer ROMs.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I don't know where to get ROMs now. I'm sure
dark
I could
web.
Find it. What'd you say?
Just deep web, yeah.
Go to the dark web?
Yeah.
I don't ever want to go on the dark web.
I kind of want to. It's not horrible. Oh, sorry.
There are parts of it that are horrible.
Oh,
okay, there's a difference.
Yeah, dark web is the well.
Oh, okay.
Dark web is a subset of the deep web.
Yes, got
deep
it. It's the horrible part of the deep web.
That's right.
I got it. It's like the Marianas Trench of the deep web. It goes
a
lot
just
deeper.
It's like stuff that's not indexed by search engines, right?
For the most part, yeah.
So, like, most of it is just, like, inane shit that like submission form pages and stuff.
Yeah. You know what the crazy part is like they have like all these websites have non-Nintendo ROMs, you know? But those are gone too.
try Emu Paradise is somebody told me that's a website. I've never used it myself, of course.
No, Emu Paradise is also does not offer ROMs
anymore. Yeah.
Yep.
Really?
Yep.
Yeah.
I think they probably still offer emulators, but not the ROMs, because the emulators aren't illegal, because those are reverse engineered.
Mm-hmm.
But the actual copyrighted game ROMs are.
Yeah. So even like, oh man, that really sucks for like people that build arcade cabinets with Raspberry Pis and shit.
Uh huh. If you want arcade games, you can't get them anymore. Let me just see. I'm on Emu Paradise. I'm going to attempt to download Pac-Man 1982, the Atari 2600 version.
Let me just download. Let's see what happens. It's technically under abandonware.
I have a 2600 emulator somewhere.
I don't think that you can download it from Emu Paradise anymore, because when I go to the download page, there's no download link anymore.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. So like, instead of just changing the whole site.
Like it's the literally the exact same way it was before.
Remove one link from the template.
Yep, there's no longer a download section for anything. So you can still chat about certain games and ROMs and everything, but you don't. That's crazy. This game is unavailable. Like all ROMs are unavailable. Crazy.
Man,
but you know
what a world.
Yeah, it just kind of sucks, Nintendo. No offense, but like. You guys aren't putting out games.
We'll just have if to I want to play to Geeks an Mania old game to play our old games.
I know.
Or I still have some ROMs, I guess, from Retro Neon Arcade, so I can play that.
Oh, I know. I have stuff too, but like I've lost my ROM collections throughout the years. You know, with you know different hard drives dying and whatnot, so. No, but like I used to play a lot of arcade games on emulator, like MAME, like because there's a lot of stuff that you can't get anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like for instance, Sunset Riders. Although now they've released it, I believe, on arcade Xbox Arcade. But for a while, that was my favorite game, and you just couldn't play it anywhere. So it was like one of my favorite arcade games. And but now it's I think
I wonder if this opens the door for like. A company to open up that just buys the rights to a bunch of abandonware and has like a game streaming service or something.
Yeah. Well, the problem with buying the rights to abandonware is that it's abandoned, so you don't know where you can get the rights from.
Yeah.
And the problem with copyright law is it doesn't really have I think 35 years or something. It ends if nobody's like renewing the license or whatever, so
something
we haven't gotten that far with games really.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or maybe it's 50 years or something, so yeah. Anyway,
well, we can still play Tetris because nobody owns that.
Oh well, a lot of people own Tetris now, I think.
Yeah,
but
this company licenses it to other companies and all this other stuff. Yeah, I need to play Tetris Effect, especially.
I know, me too. I've heard this really good.
And I want to play it in VR.
Yeah. Is that... I think it's on PSVR, but is it on other VR systems too?
I don't know. Is it on other systems at all?
I have no clue. I have not played it. I've heard of it.
Tetris PS4 for sure.
Is...
Well, PSVR... I've heard that VR is pretty good, but not like necessary. Like even the non-VR game is really good.
Yeah, it just says platform PlayStation 4. So I could play it on non-VR PlayStation, I suppose.
Okay, yeah.
But, like, what's the point of that?
But do you know what the Tetris effect is?
It's where you close your eyes and you see Tetris bits.
Yeah.
But it's more than that. It's just the name of a general effect of doing something repetitive so long that you start seeing that thing in other non-related things.
Yeah, I get it all the time. So much.
I mean, the obvious thing with Tetris was, like, when I was a kid and I played a ton of Tetris on my Game Boy, going to school and then seeing all the square tile blocks on the floor and just being like, oh, here's Tetris pieces. Oop, oop, oop. I can see where they all connect together. And it's just like, yeah. So
yeah. I remember in high school when I first started playing with Photoshop that I was walking home from school one day and I was, like, looking at the trees like, okay, just cut that out, copy that, paste it over there, do an autofill there. I also got out a lot with Guitar Hero back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like it's more pronounced on stuff that has like bright primary colors.
I mean, mm-hmm. the idea, or at least what it does to your brain, is tangentially related to the idea of synesthesia, which is mixing of senses.
Mm-hmm.
But it's something that can be done visually. It's auditory. I'm sure that taste memory is, yeah. or scent memory as well, has something to do with that as well. You know, the idea is like, I get deja vu with certain scents, whether it's, you know, I smell this scent and I'm thinking of something from my childhood or whatnot, but
mm-hmm.
those kind of cross connections in your brain are very, very intriguing and something that we can measure in some way, but we don't know how it works.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's so much about our brains that's just like, we can measure but not understand the underlying process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like, I'm trying to think, like, I think smell is one of the most,
oh yeah,
senses that's like closely tied to your memory,
which yeah. is weird because it's like one of our least sensitive smells.
It's not like our sense of smell is particularly strong as humans, you know, and a lot of people have issues with it, but it's just kind of one of those. It's probably like an evolutionarily like strong thing, you know. Maybe smell is very important for survival, so it's
mm-hmm.
just was originally built that way. And
I think that it's just the change in scent. Like if you go from like a scent neutral, something that you're just completely used to, you get that change in scent, and immediately your mind goes into instinct mode, and from there it's pulling from okay, what's this? You know.
Yeah.
And that's why you get the smell. Your first sense is a sense of either comfort or dread, and then you start actually processing what you're smelling.
Yeah. I think one of my like, scent is such like a really like fun sense. Like, I just like, there's certain smells that when I smell it brings me right back, you know. And it's just kind of one of those things that is just weird in your brain. I don't know how to describe this. It's just weird. Like, I have a specific sense and smell of like Mountain Dew that is ingrained in my mind of my childhood, because when my parents had a farm, and we used to go out and help my dad work on the farm on the weekends for my grandfather, mm-hmm. and he would always have Mountain Dew in the fridge where they kept all of the pig medicine. You know, just yeah. sharing the same fridge. And I think there's probably beers in there for the adults, but for us little kids, it was like, have Mountain Dew. And so I have this like super specific like sense memory of drinking Mountain Dew out of a can that brings the smell of the pig medicine back like in my brain.
And what does pig medicine smell like?
Just like medicine-y.
Oh, okay.
Just like
kind of a,
like
a weird sterile smell.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's just weird. It's just like drinking out of a can, though, like because it's that metallic aluminum yes, smell yeah. of the can, because it goes right up into your nose. It just brings that back, because like, yeah, back to being like six and getting a Mountain Dew out of the fridge in the barn,
medicating those pigs
with the Mountain Dew.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, if I gave the pig the Mountain Dew, then oh no.
It's the best bacon you've ever had.
Yeah.
Speaking of Mountain Dew, though, TJ.
Yeah, that leads into a really nice segue that we did not plan.
Yeah.
So, over the past couple of months, there have been a couple
of... Smell of a fresh Mountain Dew.
Smell of a fresh Mountain Dew.
That's a good smell.
It is. Although, I think I've mentioned this on the podcast before, specifically with Mountain Dew Code Red, I have specific... Like, I like Code Red out of a fountain the best. Uh-huh. Code Red out of a can, the second best. Code Red out of a bottle, the third best.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, so over the past couple months, there have been a couple new Mountain Dews that have come out.
I'm glad we have our resident junk food expert. Junk yes. drink, maybe.
Yes.
Not junk food, junk.
I am a
soda pop expert.
Sodamelier.
Oh, that could be an episode title right there. The Sodamelier.
Sodamelier.
Okay, here's our bumper.
Oh, that's subtle but nice. I love it. Mountain Dew decided, hey, let's come out with a frickin' Sprite.
Okay.
The Mountain Dew Ice?
Mountain Dew Ice is just lemon lime soda, like 7-Up, Sprite.
They should just call it Mountain Dew Hangover.
The one that they own, Sierra Mist.
Oh, yeah.
There's actually a little history with that. Pepsi and 7-Up used to have kind of a tentative partnership for a while. 7-Up was kind of the lemon lime soda of Mountain Dew, of PepsiCo, mm-hmm. even though they were completely unaffiliated and a completely different company. And once they were forced to, like, yeah, no, you can't make this partnership anymore, PepsiCo went ahead and came out with their lemon lime soda of their own by just changing the words in Mountain Dew to similar words. Mountain became Sierra, and Dew became Mist. Great. So PepsiCo decided to make a Sierra Mist caffeinated.
And that's really is Mountain Dew Ice caffeinated?
Yes, it is caffeinated.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Ooh.
But unlike other Mountain Dews, see, I've got the same problem with Mountain Dew Ice that I do with the standard recipe of Mountain Dew Pitch Black, which is the grape one.
Oh, I love the Pitch Black, though. Don't you?
Don't
you tread on me.
Does it taste like Vin Diesel?
See, Pitch Black.
Go ahead.
I have never seen a.
This is what Vin Diesel's movie, sweat is.
I've never seen Pitch Black. Movie, and I've heard they're great, but anyway. Mountain Dew Ice just tastes like 7-Up. Just tastes like Sierra
Mist. It really does. Yeah. Well, not 7-Up. 7-Up's got a distinct flavor.
A little bit, but it's there's nothing Mountain Dew about it in terms
it
doesn't
just
have that
line.
Weird off taste of being something very manufactured. It's just, okay, this is a smooth Sierra Mist lemon lime drink. Cool. And it just happens to be caffeinated. And some people will love that. And that's the same, like I said, that's the same issue I had with Pitch Black. It just tastes like grape soda to me. It's grape
Fair
soda,
enough.
Nothing.
I think it tastes like grape soda with the Mountain Dew tang, though.
I don't get that. I got that more when they reformulated it the second year they had it, which is Pitch Black 2. And that was sour grape soda.
Mm-hmm.
And I liked it.
My issue is that if it tastes like 7-Up, then for me it's going to taste like a sick day.
That's true. Man, and that was like a weird thing.
I've done that.
It was 7-Up and saltine crackers for me whenever
I was
home.
For me, it
was
always ginger ale. And
oh,
yes,
man. I'm so glad I didn't have ginger ale because I fucking love it now.
I've had both.
I still love it.
And it doesn't ruin it for me. But I will have Mountain Dew Ice, like, room temperature if I just want to settle
my stomach.
It's
got more alcohol than Mountain Dew Light.
Yeah, exactly.
The alcohol content's higher.
Hey,
so.
Man, we got a keg of Mountain Dew Ice.
So anyway, a couple months after launch of Mountain Dew Ice, they came up with Mountain Dew Ice Cherry.
Okay.
Which is
essentially Wait. Yep. Next, are they going to do Mountain Dew Vanilla Ice?
You know, vanilla lemon lime sounds wait, I've had that before.
That sounds really bad. I don't even like vanilla Coke very much.
I love
vanilla Coke. It tastes like cupcakes.
Yeah. I like vanilla Pepsi better. At least in the
can. I didn't even know there was a vanilla Pepsi.
Do you remember lemon Pepsi?
You remember Lemon Party?
.org. Go to lemonparty.org.
Pepsi Blue?
Oh, man,
that was
bad. We used
to have Pepsi Blue over at... over in college in Marshall Hall, they had that in the vending machine.
I don't remember Pepsi Blue.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
It was berry flavored Pepsi.
Yeah, it looked like fucking Gatorade or something.
It looked real bad.
Yes, and most people didn't like it. I was one of the few that did.
Wait, Contemporary Can? They still make this, man.
They still make Pepsi Blue? I gotta find it.
Did they start remaking Crystal Pepsi too?
Yeah, it's been on.
Yeah, here it is.
I've had it.
It's in Philippines.
But anyway, Mountain Dew Ice. Okay, go ahead.
Sorry, in Manila, Philippines, Pepsi Blue was sold for a limited time in late 2002 to commemorate a championship of the 8-0 Blue Eagles in the UAAP. I don't know what that is. Some sort of sport league?
Probably.
Athletic basketball team.
Okay.
Pepsi released Pepsi Blue in Metro Manila, Philippines, as Pepsi Pinas.
Pepsi Penis.
It's P-I-N-A-S. Was successful. It became a permanent product and was renamed as Pepsi Blue.
But that's a pineapple Pepsi, though.
It is.
Because Pepsi Pinas is pineapple Pepsi.
Oh, well, it says it's
well, there's bottles and cans. There's no twiddly over the ends. It's not an Enye. Is it still the same? Is it still pineapple?
Yeah, I think so. No, that's something else.
I'm only saying this because if you find it, if you go on the Wikipedia page, there is a new logo Pepsi can that says Pepsi Blue.
Okay.
And it is the shockingly blue potion elixir that was the Mountain Dew or Pepsi Blue. Fuck, man. Pepsi Blue is so bad. Such a mid-early 2000s type soda.
Exactly.
Oh, man, I'm looking at all these
weird... Filipino slang word that's short for Filipinas.
Okay.
I guess.
Anyway.
I think it's just back to the... short for Pepsi Philippines.
Okay. Fair enough. Back to
it was called Pepsi Twist. Was the lemon one. That's
I hated that. Hated it.
Yeah, it was okay.
It was just Pepsi with a nasty lemon twang. It was not the best lemon.
Do you remember Diet Pepsi Jazz?
I remember. I didn't drink it.
There was a... Diet cherry.
Oh, no, I remember that, but I don't remember.
Strawberries and cream and caramel cream.
Yeah, I didn't
it sounds terrible. Last
16 upsetting soda flavors from Smosh.
God, get out of here.
The page isn't loading.
Yeah, we could review that later.
Let's TJ get his through his thing here. I want to hear his actual real advice, not our garbage about all this.
Ice cherry is just your, I don't think so. And then I want to say it was that next day I went to the grocery store. Oh, here's a Christmas mix Mountain Dew.
Can I guess what it tastes like?
Go ahead.
So before we did the show, I guessed whether it was green and red mixed together, and you said it's not that.
But there was a green and red mixed together in the past, but this isn't it.
So my new guess is that it's like mojito flavored, where it's lime with mint for the mint representing Christmas.
Lime with mint. That's green and green, but
damn it.
All right, TJ, wait a minute. So this Christmas flavor just thinking is like, red and green?
I was just thinking like mint is a Christmas flavor.
No, Matt had said red and green as cause they had done that in the past for Christmas.
Hmm. What's the color of this again?
The bottle does show red and green. But this is kind of a – it's not last year's, which was kind of a brownish color because of the red and green mix. But this one is more of just a darker red.
Okay. Mm. Is it cranberry flavored?
Yeah, it's cranberry.
Cranberry and
–
lime. Cran lime.
Cranberry pomegranate.
Oh, shit.
That sounds pretty good.
That actually
it
does
is pretty
good.
It's – it's crisp but refreshing. It's smooth. It goes down nice.
I could see pomegranate. Just like a straight up pomegranate soda would be really good.
I don't know if they have a diet version of this.
Wow.
Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. PepsiCo's weird.
If you want to spend some Wikipedia whole time, go to the Wikipedia list of Pepsi variations.
Yes. So many.
There are so many. In Japan, there's Pepsi Azuki, an Azuki bean-flavored Pepsi that existed for a year. The diet variants? Oh, God. What? Pepsi Light Mojito.
Oh, sold in Germany. Lime.
Yeah.
I'm also really surprised that for as long as Livewire has still been doing halfway decent, that we've not had a Diet Livewire.
Livewire is my favorite Mountain Dew variation.
It's definitely one of my favorites. I mean, Game Fuel is just Livewire mixed with Code Red, but...
Now, I have a question for you. Do you remember Storm?
Was that the 7-Eleven exclusive for a while?
No, Storm was a lightly carbonated, caffeinated, lemon-lime flavored soft drink. It was test marketed by PepsiCo in some areas of the U.S. in 1998 as Pepsi's attempt to become more competitive in the clear lemon-lime soda market, which was dominated by Sprite.
I think Storm probably got replaced later with the Sierra Mist.
Mm-hmm.
But it's weird because though that partnership with Pepsi and 7-Up was going on for a while in most parts of the country, there are still parts of this country to this day that at least the distributors of soda, Dr. Pepper is distributed as a Coke product by Coke distributors in the South.
I remember having Pepsi Storm. I remember having Storm.
Well, you can still get, I think you can usually find Dr. Pepper in Coke machines, even around here.
I mean, that's a little different than, like, this would be the entire 12-pack would still be listed as a Coke product in the store.
I think one of the root beers, maybe Barks, is the same way, where it's technically a separate company, but it's completely, like, canned and distributed by Coke.
I think you're thinking, maybe, because A&W has a weird thing, because A&W restaurants used to be a Yum Brands restaurant, which is owned by PepsiCo, but A&W root beer... is the 7-Up root beer?
Yeah, that brand of sodas.
Yeah, because
Storm cans, by the way, they were mostly around during 1999. It was the Phantom Menace cans everywhere. I remember these specifically.
Oh yeah, and then it was immediately the Pepsi cans of that,
and then it was immediately dropped. Milwaukee was one of the test markets, so for sure Wisconsin had some
didn't Storm. Get up as far as me.
Lemon lime slice was and then they also had lemon lime slice, which is what they took instead of it, and then they dropped that and made Sierra Mist slice, also a soda I remember getting tons of as a kid.
Oh yeah,
it doesn't exist anymore.
Slice is still around. It's crushed now,
correct? So discontinued in the late 2000s, early 2010s.
Here's
the saddest. Slice was discontinued at an unknown date in the United States between the late 2000s to early or mid 2010s by no longer being listed on PepsiCo's product locator website. They just like pulled it without any fanfare. I mean, I don't have any like deep love for Slice, but like there was.
Oh no! Wait, no, they would. No, Fanta is Coke. Fanta is Coke.
Fanta is Nazi Coke.
Yes, so Nazi Coke.
They just partnered with Crush then, instead, because I don't think Crush is 7-Up.
I don't know. All I know is Barks is an American soft drink. Its brand of root beer is notable for having caffeine. Barks, created by Edward Bark, and bottled since the turn of the 20th century, is owned by the Bark family, but bottled by the Coca-Cola Company. It was known as Bark's famous old-timey root beer until 2012.
All right. I got some great discontinued soda flavors here.
All right.
Remember tis the season. Pepsi Holiday Spice.
Oh, was that the cinnamon one?
I don't remember.
No, that was Pepsi Fire.
That's Pepsi Fire.
That's Pepsi Fire.
And after your meal, you can have some Pepsi Bismol.
Pepsi Holiday Spice. You want a vintage 20-ounce bottle of Pepsi Holiday Spice for $30?
Fucking clove and nutmeg and shit?
I'm reading right here. So people really like Pepsi Spice, I guess, or Pepsi Holiday Spice. It was 2004. I guess this person is speaking very fondly of it in this article, saying it had a mystery blend of holiday spices.
Yeah. Well, just thinking of like what's usually in winter spice beers, it's like nutmeg and cloves, yeah, and a little ginger, bit of cinnamon. Yeah.
I gotta look up. Okay, this pumpkin article spice is like eight. Oh wait, here we go. Mm-hmm. Nutmeg and cocoa were added to the ingredients for that at some point.
That doesn't sound terrible.
Pepsi holiday spice flavor. Oh man, I completely forgot about this, but I probably have had this. Oh man.
Can we do a thing on the show where we buy old cans of soda?
Oh god, no, because they are horrible. What did Pepsi holidays... Here's a person saying Pepsi holiday spice was disgusting and I want it to come back.
if any of our patrons want to give a direct direct donation, oh, I will drink some of these crappy sodas.
Okay, yeah. Pepsi holiday spice.
If there's enough outcry, we'll take out a PO box and you can send us gross shit to eat.
I've got it. So there's a website called The Impulsive Buy. It has an article from November 8th, 2004 reviewing Pepsi holiday spice. We got this. The internet was around back then. So
just let's barely see here.
So what does Pepsi holiday spice taste like? It has a nice spicy cinnamon and ginger taste that's really good.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like this guy gave it 8 out of 10. It's like Pepsi, but with a little bit of spice to it.
Something tells me that people with a more boring palate like me would consider that a little bit of a raunchy aftertaste. Just like it lingers.
Yeah, they're saying Pepsi Fire has a similar flavor profile.
Okay.
But it's much, much like heavier on the cinnamon. Or is this a much lighter cinnamon? It was like a spicy Pepsi. Oh, that's so cool.
I have great news.
What?
On eBay, you can get a pre-owned can of Pepsi Holiday Spice dated 2005 for $5 plus $5 shipping.
Pre-owned can?
TJ, do not drink a 13-year-old soda.
Or you can get a 20-ounce plastic bottle that looks like garbage because it looks like, I don't know, something happened to it where it deflated completely.
Oh, pre-owned can, as in there's no soda left in it.
Pepsi Holiday Spice can.
It's just the can. It's can only.
Oh, is it open?
I can't see the top.
Let's see the top. No, it's still sealed.
That's not a live picture. Pre-owned can doesn't make sense unless it was drank.
And we all know Crystal Pepsi. We all know Orbits.
Oh, no, it says the can is in great shape. With no dents, the liquid has apparently drained out the bottom. where the contents ate a small pinhole in it, so the soda dissolved through the can.
If I'm ever going to drink a 13-year-old can of soda, I would want it to be a can and not a bottle.
Yeah,
I think that aluminum would be better than plastic. It'll still be flat as crap. I've had 4-year-old cans of soda before.
Let's just search for Star Wars Episode 1.
About 3 sips before I was done.
Pepsi cans complete set.
Ooh, should be.
Star Wars Episode 1, Phantom Menace, complete Pepsi soda can set, plus the gold Anakin for $25, plus $30 shipping.
Varieties of Coca-Cola. So the holiday spice I had forgotten about, so that's a good one. Neat. And they brought Surge back recently.
Yeah, I've had it. It's
no Josta. Remember Josta Cola?
No, I don't remember Josta.
It was
rare, full 16-ounce Pepsi Cola holiday plastic label stubby soda bottle. I don't think that's
so. It was kind of like berry like. It basically tasted like energy drink because it had guarana in it.
Okay,
so weird.
DNL. Remember good old DNL?
Oh, I love DNL.
That was 7-Up upside down.
Yes.
And so the logo was the 7-Up logo, but flipped upside down, so it was DNL.
Yep.
Oh,
tasted like kind of halfway between Mountain Dew and Mellow Yellow.
It was Mountain Dewy. It was their like hip, cool, rad, like mid-2000s, like snowboarding, like drink, like gotta get upside. It's taking the flavor upside down.
And then around that same time, Mountain Dew had MDX, which was their halfway between energy drink and soda. It was their energy soda, as they call it.
This is crazy.
Yep.
Wait, Mountain Dew Holiday Brew. Is that the new thing?
Yeah.
I'm on the Mountain Dew wiki, so.
There's too
I know
much
I'm
there.
In the right place.
Is There's it too much there.
The Mountain Dew Wikipedia page or a separate wiki for Mountain
no,
Dew?
No, it's the wikia.com Mountain Dew.
Oh, good.
Okay.
This is Game Fuel. Oh, all Dicky. These amazing flavors. Orange so Cranberry things. Kickstart? That doesn't exist anymore. Limeade Kickstart doesn't exist anymore. Is Kickstart you can only get at Taco Bell, right? Or are they still...
No, they have it other places, but okay. They have the orange Kickstart at Taco Bell.
Yeah, it's okay. It's like a less sugary Mountain Dew flavor.
Yeah, it has actual juices in there, too.
Yeah, it has a, like 5% orange juice or something. It's like really low.
Matt, Mountain did you do anything this week that you want to talk about?
I'm sorry, yeah, we got to talk about Mountain
Dew. I'm cool with this. Like, I was just talking about how sad, like, connecting our two... threads this episode how sad it is that I can't get a ROM from 7-Up Cool Spot, the greatest game of all time.
Yep.
Talk to me after the show.
All right.
Anyway.
Yeah, I was about to say, TJ, I need to know as well.
Yeah, okay.
Also, the Rocko's Modern Life game, if you have...
talk to me after the show.
Okay.
I've got my SNES Classic, and I need to fill it full of garbage.
Talk to me.
I have an actual SNES, but
I do too.
I can't help you with that. Well, I got three of them, but it's fine.
So let's talk after the show. Matt, what's your life?
Oh God, what is my life? I've been playing this game. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's everybody hates it. It's Fallout 76. I talked about it last time. But that's all.
That's
I'm doing with
that
my life.
Fallout Boy.
Yeah.
Game.
Except we're not joking. So many people hate this game.
Yeah, I don't
people
know.
People really hate this game.
I don't
game.
Really get the like. It is buggy, but that I don't know. I guess like maybe we like you shouldn't expect that from Bethesda, but I do.
I think the big thing that everyone's upset about is it's still running off of an 8-year-old janky engine.
Yeah. And I remember people saying that about Fallout 4, but I don't know. John, you played it for the first time today. Like, it looks
good
for an 8-year-old engine.
Yeah, like it looks really good, actually. I mean, Metacritic is not kind right now, but also looking at Metacritic, they got all the main publications are in here now with the scores. Mm-hmm. US Gamer gave it 44 out of 10.
How does PC versus console look in terms of Metacritic?
Oh, yeah. I'm looking
sometimes
at,
that is a
bigger
Oh,
I'm looking
issue.
At PC.
Okay.
So I don't know how to change platforms on Metacritic. Oh, here we go. Let's see what the PlayStation 4 reviews are. Not that Metacritic really matters, because...
No. Is that mostly just... consolidation of professional critics, or does that
it's consolidation of professional critics? Yeah.
Okay, because I know the user reviews have been completely useless because it's bombed by people that haven't actually played the game.
Yeah. Well, it's one of those things that's become like popular to hate on.
Yeah,
you know what I mean, like. This is like someone bitching about how they were told they get a refund and then they didn't.
Like, well, I've said it before and now I'll say it again. If the game ends up just becoming completely deserted, then I'll create a YouTube series where I role play as the last person left alive in West Virginia.
It seems to be a lot of fun co-op. I mean, like, I think a lot of people are like, well, I want to play Fallout, but co-op.
Yeah.
And this is kind of it.
And a lot of like the bugs with the game are just kind of growing pains with Bethesda jumping into online co-op for the first time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like they were not super well prepared for that. There's a lot of stuff just with like server ping times where you'll stumble upon like an enemy and there will be a like a little bit of lag before it reacts to you. So if you're fast enough, you can just kill it before it notices you're there.
I mean, I wouldn't give Bethesda a lot of like credit for this game because it is not good in like its release.
Yeah.
Like it has a lot of problems. And it definitely doesn't feel like a full, like this feels like their first attempt at this kind of game and not like the fully fleshed out type of game that everyone, you know, would expect from them. Mm-hmm.
I would say, but it depends a lot on what they do next. If they support it and they release a ton of new content on like a regular basis, that would be good.
Yeah. I think, at least from what I played with Matt, that it seems like it would be a lot of fun as a co-op game.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Especially when you get high level and you get into the nuked out areas.
Yeah. With the really powerful enemies.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the things that sounds like it would be really nice is the fact that progression, you're going to want to progress differently if you're playing co-op for the majority of the game. So, you know, if you want to kind of take more of an active beat 'em up role, you're going to focus more on your strength and all the things that are related to killing things with guns quickly. And if you want to, you know, be more of a support, you're going to maybe work on charisma, intelligence, and it seems customizable that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Although, and so I've taken kind of a stealth sniper approach.
What does charisma do if you're on, if there's no NPCs?
Charisma is mostly a support thing now, where you get
buffs.
There's
experience game buffs.
The only charisma perks I have are Lone Wanderer, so I get buffs if I'm not grouped. But there's a lot of
I have my perk card for charisma that I got is a buff for being in a group.
Mm-hmm. And intelligence is mostly, since there's not a lot of like int checks to pass, there's a lot of the quality of the gear that you craft is based on your intelligence skills.
Okay.
So like everything breaks with use, and with intelligence you have the ability to craft stuff that's beyond 100% condition.
Like this is apparently a game that Reddit has shit its fucking entire bottom out over.
It depends. If you go to the r/Fallout subreddit, you'll get nothing but hate. If you go to r/FO76, you'll get a lot of praise. But that's similar to what I noticed in with Fallout 4 when it came out. The Fallout 4 specific subreddit was having a good time. The Fallout general subreddit was just talking about how it wasn't
New Vegas.
It's not New Vegas. Give the license back to Obsidian.
I do like Fallout New Vegas a lot. That was a really good game.
Yeah, but when that came out, people shit on it too.
Oh, I know.
Yep.
People were like, "This is just a Fallout 3 mod."
Yeah.
Now people think of it as like fondly remembered as an incredible thing.
It's the Wind Waker of Fallout games.
Yeah,
I might buy Fallout New Vegas if I can get like, I mean, it's pretty cheap, and I could get like an up-res texture pack from.
Yeah. There's lots of fan mods for that game.
Because the thing I remember from that was I just really liked being a cowboy in that game.
Well, that game has a really good storyline, like, and really like well-written like plot.
Even better than 3.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Way better than 3. 3 wasn't great. You're just kind of like, it had really fun companions and like the setting was very different than
it was very role play heavy.
Well, and it wasn't as much like bombed out like cities as much as it was like desolate deserts and little like ghost shanty towns and weird, like, you know, like one of my favorite areas in that was the giant like dinosaur.
Yeah, the T-Rex statue.
Mm-hmm. Like, there's some really, just really cool, like, set pieces in that game. But did you hear from Reddit that this law firm is investigating Bethesda for deceptive trade practices?
Oh, cool. That sounds like a real thing.
Yeah,
I heard that Reddit. Yeah,
yeah. This
not that I'm following it, but
I like what I heard from Reddit was that John Carpenter is playing Fallout 76. Yeah. So I'm gonna hang out with him, and we're gonna like talk that movies, and I'm gonna make
comicbook.com.
I'm gonna be like, hey, if you make a movie, do you need a soundtrack for it? And they'll be like, yeah. And then that's how I become famous.
It just seems like this is not at all real. Like, you can say we're investigating like this, and it's like there's nothing you can do though. Like it's a consumer good.
I would say it's like some kind of PR thing, or
oh yeah, it's probably. Well, I mean, if you look at
they could actually scam money out of people for.
Exactly, they've updated this Reddit thing because their like website crashed. So many people were looking at it, and they're like, "Hey, check out our Facebook page and all this other stuff." I was like, "Okay, yeah, you're just."
And it's just you can say we're looking into it. That doesn't mean there's an actual case there.
Oh yeah, exactly. Because of course they'll say they're looking into it because it's a popular thing to hate on right now. I think that at least from what I've read with a lot of people on Quarter to Three forums talking about, as they said, like I like, and I kind of agreed because the way I like to play all the other Fallout games was I never really mainlined the story. I just kind of liked wandering around and like looking at all the stuff.
Yeah.
And like seeing like the little storylines, like going upon a house and like seeing like the corpses and like reading about how like they like got killed by ghouls and then
and you know, now in this game you do that, but there's a holotape there where you can hear the final moments of
what but that was kind of the way it was in Fallout. Like if you're not in a city area, there weren't a lot of NPCs, you're just kind of finding stuff. I don't know. Anyway, I think
so. I just want to do a quick like streamer YouTuber rundown for Fallout if you're interested in more content. If you want lore, check out Oxhorn. He's very story driven. If you want game mechanics and gameplay, check out Many a True Nerd. And if you want general fucking around, check out Nerdcubed, who's doing a series with Many a True Nerd where he just seems to annoy him a lot the whole time and blow shit up and get himself killed.
Nice.
Oh, I've got a tiny Verve update. Because Verve added another thing in the past 2 weeks.
Oh, yes.
And not talk about High Dive.
Mm. Verve, the streaming service.
Verve.co.uk. /K12.
VRV.
VRV.
For Vendetta.
To our one Canadian listener.
Ah,
sorry.
Yeah.
Hey.
Sorry, I'm talking about this.
A boat.
It's a boat. But anyway.
A boot.
Verve added Boomerang.
Boomerang?
Classic cartoons. Yep.
Why is that Canadian?
Because Boomerang is essentially Canadian Cartoon Network. Well, it's Cartoon Network's other channel.
What the fuck? Is that Canadian?
It's Canadian?
No, it's not Canadian. It's fucking Looney Tunes and Tom and Jerry and Flintstones. And Wacky Races.
And everything Scooby-Doo. Everything Scooby-Doo.
Yeah, I don't know why this is like Canadian, though. But this is like what Cartoon Network used to show back when I was a little kid.
It was a Canadian subchannel of Cartoon Network, and then we got Boomerang later.
I don't know. Wikipedia says...
I don't know where you're
getting it was headquartered in Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay,
Georgia.
The famous Canadian company in Atlanta, Georgia.
All right, I will admit I'm wrong.
Georgia, the Canadian province.
It's the only time.
Wait a minute. Wacky Races.
They definitely have super fair elections.
Wait, Wacky Races 2017. Okay, excuse me. That is not what I'm into. This is losing steam here.
The most important thing on here.
They got Jetsons and Flintstones.
Can I say the weirdest thing that I came across in this Wikipedia article about Boomerang just by randomly scanning?
Sure.
Martin Luther King Jr. Day. In observance of MLK Day, Boomerang aired various episodes from The Garfield Show.
Civil rights.
Yeah.
Champion.
So Jetsons Meet the Flintstones is on here. You can watch that full movie.
Yeah, we
but
got
more
Yogi.
More importantly, the Jetsons and WWE Robo WrestleMania.
No.
Oh, man. So do they have the whole like Hanna-Barbera catalog?
No. Not the whole thing. And there's some new stuff too.
There's some gaps in here. They do have Johnny Quest though, I saw.
They do have Johnny Quest, yep.
They have the Return of Space Godzilla Ghost, 1984.
No Space Ghost. I didn't see any up here. They have a newer Duck Dodgers series, I think.
They got a bunch of Christmas specials. They have the Flintstones Christmas, a Flintstone Christmas Carol, a Flintstone Family Christmas.
I'm going to take Garfield issue with that. Christmas the Flintstones special. Were pre-Jesus, so that's not going to work for me.
Courage the Cowardly Dog. The animated series Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs. It just feels a little off.
This says Bugs Bunny. What does that mean? Oh, okay. No, these are old classics.
Yeah, there's tons of Looney Tunes, Duck Dodgers. Tom and Jerry.
Because they have some new Looney Tunes. That
Tom and Jerry
like,
Classic and Tom new and Jerry old, New. Yeah.
But there are old ones on here, so I'm in on that. Daffy Duck. Oh, this is
so
good
much
stuff
Tom
in
and
here.
Jerry.
Is Camp so Lazlo that but one show that...
They don't have Garfield and Friends. They just have some Garfield no. movies.
Yeah. Is Camp Lazlo that show that that Spanky and Ewan keep wanting us all to watch?
What show? No.
Camp Lazlo.
No, I think what they... Oh, maybe... Were they talking about?
I don't know. I'd have to listen to their podcast while away.
Yeah, well, they'll have to come on this show for me to listen to their podcast. So fuck
okay,
them.
Fair enough.
Yeah, fuck you.
Fuck you, Ewan. Fuck
I have,
Ewan.
I have listened to every episode of that show. So can they say that
oh,
about
God.
My show?
I have the Garfield Christmas special on VHS at my
but
parents' house.
I can't
house.
Even say that about. But our show.
Okay.
I'm about 20 episodes behind on our show.
They what have the Magilla, fuck are you doing with your life?
Magilla Gorilla. They have...
There's a series called Barney Bear that, like, from the cover art, looks like sexy comic book porn of, like, maybe Yogi Bear.
They have a pup named Scooby-Doo.
They do,
do you remember
a pup
named Scooby-Doo?
I love that show.
I did, too. They got a lot of Scooby-Doo, though.
Oh.
Like, they got a classic Scooby-Doo show.
I've seen Camp Lazlo back in my Nickelodeon watching days. Or oh. I guess it was Cartoon Network. But I definitely remember this monkey thing.
Yeah, lots of Looney Tunes, lots of Tom and Jerry. The short-lived show Tom and Jerry Kids, for some reason.
Yeah.
Top Cat! All the old episodes. Oh. Oh, they just have the new Wacky Races, not the classic. Oh, no,
oh,
they have the classic.
John, what
they
were you
both.
Saying that they don't have with Garfield?
They've got Wacky Races.
Because I see Garfield and Friends.
Oh, shit. Oh, they got it all. Man, I got to subscribe to Verve now.
They own our shit.
But also...
Garfield's
have...
Babes and Bullets, where he plays a noir detective.
Okay.
They finally added a bunch more stuff to the High Dive stuff, but not everything I'm ready to watch.
I would like to say that Nick Splatt has added a ton of shit too, apparently.
Salute Your Shorts is there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Is Hey Dude on there?
Hey Dude.
I loved Hey Dude.
I loved Hey Dude as well. Wacky Races was pretty good.
I always saw Hey Dude as like Salute Your Shorts, but it's a rant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What they need, though, is Wild and Crazy Kids.
Wild and Crazy, Crazy Kids. I remember watching that and loving it.
Omar Gooding was on that show.
Let's see here. What else we got? We've got... So they've added quite a bit. They have Cat Dog now.
Cat Dog was there from the beginning, I think.
Was it? Well, yeah. Let me just go through
can
the
I
shows.
Watch
Rocko's
Modern
Rocko's
Life,
Cat Modern Dog.
Life. Okay.
Yes,
you've
Rocko's
already
Modern
answered
Life.
My question, and now I've bought it.
Angry Beavers, which I loved. Keenan
Love
and Kel Angry. Is on here. I don't know if that was originally. They had all that.
It wasn't.
In Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Mm-hmm.
Doug, what they had, I believe, originally. They have Kablam, which mm-hmm. was one of my favorite shows as a kid. They have The Amanda Show, Legends of the Hidden Temple, Clarissa Explains It All. Wow. We got a lot in here. We got Guts. We got Salute Your Shorts, they added, and Figure It Out.
Oh,
but
man.
No, Hey Dude yet. But I'm sure they'll get there. And the show Rocket Power, which I hated.
Oh, but they were so extreme.
The reason why I hated Rocket Power is because I believe that was when I became... That was the show that came out when I was too old to watch Nickelodeon.
The problem with Figure It Out is it looks like newer Figure It Out, because I missed this Figure It Out that was hosted by Summer Sanders.
Correct. This is a newer version. Oh my god. We've done ads for Verve. We've done ads for various soda players.
Just look at the name of the fucking podcast, John. This is all within our wheelhouse.
You're definitely right. Hey, we're live on YouTube again, apparently.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know. That shit happens.
Wait, how am I going to edit this?
Well, we're just streaming. I'll export it, but we're just streaming.
I was about to say,
YouTube,
if you just...
in case we pick up any of our sweet new viewers at YouTube. Hi, YouTube. How are you?
There are no people on YouTube watching
this. Ario Monsters is a pretty cool
show. Did you guys get dumped with snow yesterday?
No. Zero snow.
Just come.
We got snow fucked.
Man, I don't know how your Monday went, but it went differently than mine. I got nothing over here. Yard got drenched. So yeah, you guys got... Yeah, because originally, on like Saturday, it was like, fuck, man. Sunday night, we're going to get 3 to 6 inches of snow. And then like halfway through Sunday, it said, all right, we're going to get like 2 to 4. And then like Sunday night, it was like 1 to 3. And then I woke up in the morning, like, yeah, we might get some flurries, but no accumulation. I was like, wow. I planned so hard for this, and I got nothing. What happened?
Foot.
A foot?
Oh, man.
Oh, I'm sorry,
and it
TJ.
Was nasty. It started light flurry, and then rain, and then back to flurry, and then it got bad.
Mm. We just had a cutting wind.
It's always super great when it goes back and forth between solid and liquid, so it creates this like horrible slushy mess.
Oh, yeah.
So my work closed an hour early yesterday. That never happens for businesses, but we closed an hour early yesterday.
Oh, so we could have recorded.
Yeah.
We could have recorded. Yeah, I was home.
God damn it.
I mean, I guess
we could have been playing Fallout tonight.
Now, so, but, you know.
But no, my car was full of heavy snow. I cleaned it off, came home, woke up this morning. I had to go into work, and I had another 6 inches of that snow, and it was heavy to get off my car. The roads were nasty, and it was still snowing until about 10 o'clock this morning.
But this is like it. This is the big coat. And then now the roads are getting cleared off.
Yeah. We'll have nothing for 3 months.
Yeah.
So now global warming.
Yeah, thanks. No, it's cold. It's snowing out. So how could global warming be real?
How could global warming be real? It snowed in Houston.
I brought a snowball into Congress. So
I think my favorite...
not real.
My favorite, like... description or argument to that is an image that is the Titanic sinking and the person standing on the top of the back saying, we're 100 feet in the air. How can you say the Titanic's sinking?
That's pretty good. Yeah, I think humans were not really wired to recognize
exactly
sort of
global trends,
existential threats.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's, but if you think about the way our brains are wired, that's just the way it is. I mean,
yeah,
we're wired to not be eaten by the tiger in the jungle.
Recognize the threat in front of you.
Mm-hmm. And protect our family from the tigers in the jungle. And now that we don't have to do that, we just play Fallout 76 and I protect my friend from the rad roaches.
Yeah, I protect my camp from the scorched, which is really just... I mean, they're horribly deformed people. A lot of the enemies in Fallout are just victims of radiation poisoning.
Yeah. And they're like, please don't kill me.
They're like, please,
save
I have
me.
A family.
I need to shoot them.
And but they look different, so they're a monster.
Mm-hmm. Well, it does take place in the South. well, that's the way the South was, all right?
Not West Virginia.
No.
West Virginia seceded from the Confederacy.
We got to talk about a thing that I need to bring up because it's timely. And I want everyone in the podcast to participate. And we're going to have Discord participation for listeners. And I'll post about it in the Discord for all the people that are in Discord that don't listen to
at
an hour and 40 minutes into an episode.
Discord.geeky.pvz.
I remember that.
We should make a bit.ly, like bit.ly/byte.
Okay, bit.ly/byte. All right.
BITE.
All right. So I want to talk about Whamageddon. Have you heard of Whamageddon?
No.
No, but I hope it has nothing to do with Last Christmas.
It has everything to do with Last Christmas.
Okay. First of all, I have no context here. but I want to tell you that in the loop of whatever songs play at my fucking work, I have at least 8 different covers of freaking Last Christmas that show up. It's horrible.
So this is a pretty simple thing. I'll put a link on the Discord right now. So if you're listening live, you can look up and follow along. And if you're not listening live, you can go to the Discord.
If you're not listening live, you're dead to me.
And find it and find it. So it's called Whamageddon, and it has to do with Last Christmas. It's not complicated. So the objective of Whamageddon is to go as long as possible without hearing Wham's version of the Christmas classic Last Christmas.
I've already failed.
Nope. The game starts on December 1st.
Okay.
And it ends at midnight on December 24th.
Well, I'm just going to intentionally fail because it's the best song that I've ever heard in my life.
No, it is the third worst Christmas song ever.
We'll go over this in a second. When we get through the rules, we can talk about the worst Christmas songs. Only the original version applies, so covers do not count against you.
Okay.
But the rule is, as soon as you recognize the song, even if you change the channel, you're out. So it's just that moment of recognition. This is Last Christmas by Wham. You're out. And then what you're supposed to do is post on social media with the Whamageddon hashtag. This is their website trying to get that. I want people to talk on Discord. This is like the Seinfeld, the game, you know, I'm out.
Mm-hmm.
I heard it. Also, I'm there going to say PvP will not on the Discord, please.
No.
Yeah. We can't stop you from deliberately sending your friends to Whamhalla. The intention is this is a survival game, not a battle royale, so don't be a dick. Don't send bit.ly links with a Last Christmas Wham, because that's just not fair.
There's a similar game that takes place in the UK, and they call it the Pogues game. Mm. There is a British band called the Pogues, and I forget what song that they play around Christmas time. It's exactly
what is it called? It's that... I know the song, but I can't remember what it's called.
I couldn't tell you.
So I used to on my college radio show, I called it Christmas.
Fairy Tale of New York.
Okay.
Christmas is the worst. And
you
I
used
would go
to do
through
that
the
on
worst
a podcast too.
We're going to do that again this year. Don't worry. But
all right, that's cool.
But
we should do that on Rabbit and stream it together with our.
I forget the dang name of my annual Christmas music show was. But anyway, it was 2 hours, I believe, and it was like the top 20 worst Christmas songs. It was a mixture of really popular Christmas songs that were bad, and then like really bad Christmas songs.
Yeah.
The worst Christmas song, I think, oh my god, this person, Esquire.com, must have listened to my radio, because they got a lot of my choices on here.
I have a top three of worst
number
Christmas
one
songs.
Worst Christmas song is Wonderful Christmas Time by Paul McCartney and Wings.
Wonderful
is fucking nightmare. They say the same words like 100 times.
Simply have a wonderful Christmas.
It's just like really... This is amazing because, like, they got my top five here. Lady Gaga, Christmas Tree, is one of the worst songs ever.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a really, like, bad rhythm. And her vagina is a Christmas tree, according to the lyrics.
Yeah.
And she's talking about people getting on top of her Christmas tree. It's really bad. The Jackson 5 one's not so bad. The Pussycat Dolls Santa Baby cover is really bad, but I didn't have that. Justin Bieber Mistletoe is on mine. That's really awful. Do They Know It's Christmas is in the top 10. Awful as well.
Yeah. I don't have in my top three, they're not specific artists. It's just the song. So Santa Baby is my number one worst Christmas song. All I Want for Christmas.
Whoa,
is
now
you.
Stop.
Yeah.
What version of Santa Baby?
All of them. I hate the song.
Okay. That doesn't... Come on. You got to give me... You got to give me the worst cover.
It's about a lady that wants to fuck Santa Claus.
Trust me.
Exactly.
I believe the worst version of... I think... Let me look this up.
I'm sure there is a worst of my worst, but...
Did I do a podcast version of the audio thing?
No.
I feel like I did at some point.
I think just the Christmas is Terrible movie episodes.
Yes, the Christmas is Terrible movie episode had those songs on them as like bumpers. Taylor Swift, Santa Baby is the worst one. Yeah, that one's
I agree with that.
That's a nightmare because she's not a great singer to begin with. No offense, Tay Swift. She's good enough, but that song is like a diva belting song and it just isn't right for her. The She and Him Baby, I'm just cold outside. I've never heard, but I got to imagine it's terrible. That's Zoe Deschanel and some other dude. Anyway, that song's pretty bad to begin with. There's a really bad New Kids on the Block one that I don't see on this list. This Christina Aguilera, Oh Holy Night, it's pretty good because she fucking shits her voice out a million times on that. They don't have any other ones on my list. There's a Shelley Duvall Christmas song that's really bad, one of her albums. But anyway.
So real quick, Bitly has gone corporate, and you need a professional account to customize your domains.
That's
so hilarious. Our new short URL for our Discord service is yolo420.com/born in the 80s, all lowercase.
Oh no!
Yolo420.com.
Wonderful Christmas Time was not my my worst one. Here it is. The worst one was Alvin and the Chipmunks, Christmas Don't Be Late.
Oh, fuck.
That's a nightmare to listen to.
Is it classic Alvin and the Chipmunks or modern Alvin?
No, classic. And it's awful. I hate it.
Yeah.
Classic
is worse, but I don't abhor it at all. I enjoy it.
Can I?
I like these lists though. Oh, Funky Christmas.
My least favorite Christmas song?
New Kids on the Block. That's the one. Funky Christmas.
Yeah, go ahead, Matt.
Christmas Shoes.
That's really bad. Good one.
This is fucking depressing.
Yeah.
Let me buy this pair of shoes
for
my mother
Wham's
that's
Last
dying.
Christmas. Anyway.
Last Christmas is my number three. Cover. I don't care.
I don't hate that one. Grandma got run over by a reindeer. That's not that bad.
I don't know that I've heard Last Christmas.
I think the reason why Last Christmas is listed so bad is because it's so overplayed. Well, no. Matt, you're going to have a great time with Wham again then because...
Oh,
if you
so that's
gonna
the Wham one?
Yeah. Because you have to instantly recognize it.
Yeah.
Thank you for putting my YouTube ads up.
I put those in the Twitch chat earlier when we were talking about pirating things.
Oh, that's right.
I should add it to the general Discord too. I got a VHS player to try and do some video distressing. And instead of buying new tapes, I just found some at my parents' house. That I'm excited to look through. I might have some circa 2000 commercials. The one tape I looked at so far is a very special episode of Boy Meets World where Sean's dad is in the hospital from, I guess, a heart attack, and him and his brother are having a rough child off about who had it worse.
Hey there, John here. This is the moment in which my microphone that was brand new and 3 hours old, Yeti Blue microphone, decided to die. And it takes a little while for my co-host to understand what's happening. So listen in and enjoy.
So what I'm trying to say is I might add to your playlist.
I need to at least put this in public that my number two worst Christmas song is Mariah Carey's All I Want for Christmas Is You. Hate that fucking song with a passion.
Even when you're watching
John's on mute. I can't hear John.
Yeah, I can't hear John either.
John, you're dead to us. Nope, nothing. I'm seeing your mouth move. No, not that mute.
No, the other mute.
John. John, nope. I'm watching your mouth. It's nothing.
Have you tried turning it off and on again?
This would be a great game if we were actually joking about this. Yeah, if he actually was coming through, but right now he's not. Nope. I mean, you can even look at the little bubbles. Oh, there we go. All right. It's now our podcast.
We are Matt the captains now.
You're the man now, dog. No.
Nope. If only you had a new microphone that you could try out.
Oh,
Just another flawless execution of Born in the 80s podcast.
Of course. Of course. I hope we don't end up having to play this out without John. But
I will. I will take command as the second most senior member on this podcast. I will take over.
I don't know why he just glitched out as he did. He might have to close his browser and open it again.
Yeah. I think he should probably turn it off and on again.
Yeah. Might just have to unplug or plug back in his audio device. We're still up and ready, right? Up
yep.
and going.
That's still us. It's just the TJ and Matt show.
Yeah.
Starring Matt and TJ.
I bought the new Pokemon games. The Pokemon Let's Go, the Eevee, and Let's Go, the Pikachu ones.
Yeah.
I like, got around to getting them.
You've got the Eevee one, right?
Well, I have them both, but I'm playing the Eevee one with my eldest daughter, and I have a separate file that I'm playing myself. And then we have the Pikachu one as well that the youngest two are playing.
Scrubs.
Yep. Yep. Scrubachu is absolute the worst. But I've already caught a Pikachu in my version, so I'm okay. Because
yeah.
I can evolve.
So I guess that technically means that the Eevee owns the Pikachu in your
version. No, because you can catch an Eevee.
Okay. So what is there a tangible difference between the two games, or is it just a skin thing?
No, it's just like Pokemon, the older Pokemons, where you get the two versions. They got some exclusives here, some exclusives there, and a little bit of, these are rare here. But otherwise, the capture mechanics are just like Pokemon Go.
Okay.
And when you capture, everything gains experience. John, we still don't gotcha. I know you're back, but we don't hear you. But no, every Pokemon you catch, you get experience for your party. So instead of battling wild Pokemon, you just keep catching a bunch, and you can send them back and get candies to power up your Pokemon. And...
Mm-hmm.
But you can level them up other ways, too.
Is there a limit to how many you can capture?
Just however many Pokeballs you can get.
Oh, okay.
Capture as many as you want. They don't do the regular games like having boxes. They're just like, here's your box that's in your bag. Capture as many as you want.
That's cool. That's cool.
John, if you can hear us, we can't hear you.
John has gone off screen. He appears to be under his desk now.
He's unplugging and plugging back in. Guarantee it.
Oh man, even the microphones that come with Fallout 76 are bugged.
I'm gonna peek on that. Oh, it's...
Oh, hi, John. Let's pretend we hear him. Hey, yeah, John, how are you?
I won't be able to... There's no context here, though. Yeah. I want context. I want to have a conversation with John.
I want subtext.
No, we got nothing. This is the wrong kind of...
Anyways, this has been an episode of Born in the 80s podcast. I've been your host, Matt Haig.
And I've been your co-host, TJ May.
Stick around for the bonus content where John might actually show up.
That's not how he edits these things. I need to start editing some of these, too. You know, I didn't know that this was a song in English until everyone's... I thought this was just some foreign song.
Yeah.
For the longest time.
It is English. It is the girl from Ipanema.
Where is Ipanema?
I think it's in... Southeast Asia. One of those... It's a city.
It's an area in Rio de Janeiro.
Well, fuck.
In Brazil.
I don't know shit about geography then.
Yep. There is a restaurant in Seattle called the Seattle Grill from Ipanema.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
It's a pretty solid joke there, Seattle.
This is a pretty solid joke. Good job, Seattle. That's all you got.
Just bad and, you're dead. Coffee and grunge.
Oh, it's true.
And rain. And suicide. Which also goes along with the grunge.
Yeah, but that's just...
Seattle still... Well, as of a couple of years ago when I visited there, they still don't let people use public restrooms as a result of the heroin epidemic of the 90s.
But just... it's still bad now. Everywhere.
Well, I mean...
Oh, more opioids, but, you know...
Yeah.
Yeah, John, you're not pushing through at all.
Have you tried turning it off and on again?
I can just be the voice of John. He can just type the rest of the episode.
Yeah.
I'm perfectly fine with that.
Can you narrate it like Microsoft Sam?
I could.
Speaking of, you got to get that new Rap Battle Jackbox game so we can play
some
sweet, sweet party games.
You know, I've got that... I think I have some credit left on PS Network, but I kind of want to get that and Beat Saber and Tetris Effect.
Oh, I thought you had Beat Saber.
No, because I've been waiting for it to come out on PS4, and it just came out a couple days ago. And
oh, really? I thought that was out like a while ago. I must be thinking of something else.
It's been on PC forever. And I want to play it. They announced it back in like June, and then we talked about that on the podcast, but that was it.
I should get that game. It looks really fun, and I need something that can be a game and a workout.
And on PC, you can add, like, people have done their own Beat Saber tracks, so you can...
Yeah, you can mod in, like, your own songs and stuff.
One of the ones I was watching people play is someone did a Through the Fire and Flames, because of course they did. Yeah. Every rhythm game needs a Through the Fire and Flames. Thanks, Guitar Hero 3. Even if, as much as I hate Guitar Hero 3, because that's the first Activision Guitar Hero, and I followed Harmonix.
Yeah.
Rock band.
Yeah. But it was still good.
John is still trying to do this.
Apologies for the upcoming audio, but I switched to my webcam audio, which is quite a bit worse than the microphone I had been using. So, buckle up. Well, I didn't want it
hey,
to come.
Hey, I found John.
I didn't want it to come to me switching to my fucking webcam audio, but...
John, you should get a new microphone.
It is on. The recording light is on. It's being picked up.
Is it being claimed by another program?
I mean, that must be it.
Yeah, something but grabbed it is probably what
something
happened.
Something else is like, this is mine now.
But I don't know what it would be. I have the OBS turned off.
Now that you've switched it to webcam mic, what happens if you switch it back?
It won't do it. I mean, the Yeti microphone is just not picking up audio. You know. I mean, I could just... I just don't understand. Oh, God, I fucking hate this shit. This should just work. Why is this not working?
Well, restart your computer before the next time we do a podcast. It might just be because you just got it.
I'm just searching Windows 10. Why is this not picking up audio now?
Well, Windows 10 fucks everything up. As much as I love Windows 10, there are things about Windows 10 that I hate with a passion. Like the fact that I can't go incognito on my fucking Microsoft Edge because it thinks
I'm a child. All right. If you're using Windows 10, search for microphone privacy settings. All right. Let's see here. Maybe because it's a new microphone.
Yeah, I just don't know why it would have changed in the meantime.
This is not useful.
Okay.
If you're using Windows 10, search for microphone privacy settings, which returned a Google search for or a Bing search for microphone privacy settings.
Yeah.
This is from earlier this summer.
We have recorded for quite a while. Do we want to finish with a bio?
I might actually love you. I tried everything to get this thing working and found this. Access. Maybe it's a setting in the actual thing. All right, let me just advanced.
It's just so weird to me that it just doesn't work. It's just blank. Like, it's on. I unplugged it and plugged it in. Mm-hmm. It's recognizing it as an input, and the light is on. Like,
disabled under recording devices or
anything? No, it says it's working properly. This shouldn't be happening. When I tried disabling it, enabling it, you know, properties, like levels, everything's fine. Like, I don't know why this isn't working. Why would it happen in the middle of a recording?
Just
like, why would it
the
just
the only thing I can think of is if some other program was like, this microphone's mine now.
But I don't know what would. I fucking hate this. I don't know what to do.
Have you tried restarting yet?
No, but I'll take forever.
That'll probably.
All right, give me 5 minutes to restart my computer.
Okay.
I'll try.
Anyway, yeah. I'm looking at my Pokemon Let's Go right now, or at least not mine. Look at my other daughter's. One of the things is that the way that it handles like connecting online or local wireless is you set up a code that's 3 Pokemon.
Oh, okay.
You get 10 Pokemon to choose from. You can't see this in the screen. It's too
no.
great.
But I can visualize it in my mind's eye.
That's brightness down.
There we go.
So you get 10 Pokemon, and you have to do 3 of them. It doesn't have to be 3 different. Just be in the order. That's a passcode, essentially.
Yeah, it's just
but not
a Pokemon-based passcode.
Exactly. So I'm trying to think if I can use the starting letters of these Pokemon to, like, if I ever want to do a room of myself and make a word.
Mm-hmm. How many Pokemon do you do?
There are 10 different Pokemon.
Yeah.
But you only do 3.
You
so
do 3.
Just
so it's
got to
be a
3-letter
word. Or if you can work out a way that it's the first 2 letters of each Pokemon, you can have a 6-letter word.
Oh, I could. Let's see.
Pikachu, Eevee, Eevee. And that is P.
P. It's P. Heb.
I'm very limited in my knowledge of Pokemon names.
There's 2 C's and 2 P's from doing the beginning stuff. Oh, you know what?
Charmander.
The best way to do this is just spell out the word red. You've got a Rattata, an Eevee, and a Diglett. R-E-D. So every room should be red.
Mm-hmm.
Every room that I make should be red.
Just so, like YouTube red.
So if anyone
that's
randomly
how you know
wants...
it's for adults.
Yep. Oh, it's now YouTube Premium.
Oh, I meant RedTube. I can see why they changed that.
It took them forever to do that, though.
Yeah.
But anyway, if anyone wants to just... If I happen to be online, I will... I know some people do this where they just will set a random code and look for randos instead mm-hmm. of like the whole idea is it's someone you know, so you're intentionally going to do it where they can, where you can let them know your code.
So, like, people will log on and just input a random code
exactly
with hopes that it will be an actual room.
Not even a room, it's just an individual. Okay. You only pair up with one.
Hey, it's not working, I don't think.
Cool.
No, it's not.
I'm running Audacity, and it's just getting no input.
You might have to reinstall some drivers or something. Let's answer some questions.
Oh my god, why?
Let's answer some questions, John.
All right, what?
TJ, let's do a bite of answers.
All right.
And we'll solve the world's problems, except we can't solve John's. And then...
Nope.
That's probably enough to call it a night.
All right. Now, all of these are... I like doing the singles and dating ones. Everyone seems to like those the best.
Mm-hmm.
But I want you to pick one of 3. And I'm just going to give you some vague keywords here. We've got someone who's kind of having an existential crisis.
Okay.
We've got someone who's really skittish in her relationships. I'm saying her, but I'm assuming it's... Yeah, it's definitely a female.
I'm so pissed about this.
And then we've got someone who's been in a long-term relationship and just is bored.
Okay. I feel like the existential dread one will be the funniest in terms of me fucking with the person.
Yep. Mm. Okay.
But if you want to help somebody, I don't know. Let's start with the existential dread.
And we'll just see how we go?
Yeah.
All right. The base... Now, this is from someone who decided to remain anonymous. And the title is, Why Am I Like This?
Okay.
So I noticed recently that I tend to talk to people like I'm their best... Sorry, like I'm their BFF one day. And the next day, I will do my best to avoid being in a situation where I need to talk to them again.
Okay.
I'm not trying to be rude, and neither will I show them that I'm avoiding them. I'll just avoid eye contact and act as if I didn't see them around me. Like, for instance, I met this classmate at the supermarket over the weekend, and I was genuinely happy to see them, and we had good conversation. Today, when I saw them at uni, I just act like I didn't see them and was on my phone the whole time, or reading a book in order to avoid any conversation. It's not just one person. I just feel like it's going to be awkward when I'll talk to them again because I have nothing interesting to talk about. And no, I didn't write this post.
No, I was going to say, this sounds like me. Like, this is super easy to answer because basically you're just an introvert, which means that if you don't currently have the energy for this sort of social interaction, then you're going to try and avoid it. And I don't know. I do this all the time. Especially if I run into like people I knew in high school that I haven't talked to in several years, I'll just either pretend not to know who they are or not to see them. I don't think it's necessarily the biggest deal. I think maybe if people are overly fragile, they might get offended by it. But I think just in general, people are... We'll take it at face value and assume that you didn't see them or didn't remember who they were. It's a little bit different if you're doing it with people that you know currently. Then you have to be a little more sneaky about having a distraction that'll make it plausible that you didn't see them there. My short answer is, you do you. That's totally normal. Don't worry about it. And I've solved the internet. So how's everyone else doing? Oh, just fine.
I'm writing a whole diatribe because
John's totally not paying attention because he's trying to solve computer problems. Could you send them a YouTube link to the song Don't Worry, Be Happy?
I'm already planning on it. Is that the specific one that talks about introverts versus extroverts in that respect? Or are you talking about the song?
No, I was just thinking about the song Don't Worry, Be Happy.
No, I want to send them the YouTube video about introverts that I really appreciate.
Because I definitely like... And It for me, it doesn't really seem like there's any specific cause. It's just kind of a random slot machine, whether I'm going to be feeling like I want to have a bunch of conversations with people that day, or I just want to like keep to myself and not be drained. It's really strange how it seems like there's not an actual cause to these things. It's just kind of like, well, this is the mood I'm in. Don't want to have any conversations.
Is the one I liked. ACP Science? No, maybe. If not, no. There's so many different ones, but there's a specific there's so many crap YouTube channels that I psych to go is bullshit. Bright Side is bullshit. Come on, where is it? Filter. Might be this one, but I don't think it's this one. ASAP Science, maybe?
Is it BuzzFeed Violet?
I think so.
Is it Holderness Family Vlogs?
No, because there's specific infographics.
Life Noggin.
Life Noggin, send me that link.
Hey there. Welcome.
Hold on.
God damn it.
Let me just post this.
This isn't it. It's not the stupid ASAP Science piece of crap.
I think it's by Discord. And it's in there.
Power of Introverts, not BuzzFeed. I don't think it's BuzzFeed Violet.
Check out the Discord. I feel like all of your questions will be answered in the Discord.
All right. Is it this one, though?
Is it Bright Side?
No, this is too bright from what I'm used to seeing. Maybe I shouldn't look for introvert versus extrovert, just look for introvert.
Is it Casually Explained?
It might be Casually Explained. That sounds right. I love Casually Explained.
Now, I think there's a fair bit...
Stick Figures.
Yes, I'm almost certain it is.
Then it's probably Casually... If it's not CGP Grey and it's Stick Figures, it's probably Casually Explained.
Yeah, probably. I can't get this fucking thing to work. Dude, I don't know what...
9 months ago?
Why would it stop in the middle of talking? I'm sorry. It's just fucked up. I'm trying fucking with the dials.
It's not Casually Explained. It's not Casually Explained. God damn it. My favorite introvert video, and I can't fucking find it. I hate this fucking YouTube algorithm because it's ruining all of YouTube. Because there's all these freaking... See, it looks like in the style of the Psych to Go, but it wasn't Psych to Go. I think it would be It's not a freaking TED Talk. It was a crappy animation.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm fucked. I just bought a $100 microphone that stopped working immediately. I don't even know what to do. Like, I have no clue. I'm sorry.
I'm seeing a lot of Psych to Go videos.
Yes, they're like a clickbait fucking thing that... Clickbait thing that just is all about let's get a million fucking views. Sorry, I'm really angry. If there was a way... Can I search in my history? In my overall history?
Yes.
Search watch history. I have a feeling it's actually in one of my, liked videos. Anyway, I'm not going to be able to finish this, but I'll at least mention what I wrote, but I'm going to link that video specifically. I just said, basically, you're just a social introvert. Though as social creatures, we desire human interaction, introverts gain social energy by being by themselves and expend social energy when interacting with people. Extroverts are the opposite. It's an absolutely normal thing. You're just choosing the best situations to expend your social energy. I want to get that right video. Oh, found it. It's better than yesterday. It's only got 33,000 views.
Better than yesterday.
Yes. Difference between introverts and extroverts. Introvert versus extrovert comparison. Not stick figures, but it's very simple. This is only from almost 2 years ago.
Yeah, it's very like WikiHow style art.
Yes, it's very WikiHow. I'm actually going to just post that there. Not in the text, but in my source. Okay.
All right. I think that's a good place to call the episode.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm just kind of really fucking bummed that my extremely expensive new microphone just immediately stopped working.
I'm sure it'll start working. It sounds like a software problem.
What the fuck is wrong with this thing? It just worked.
Have you tried
for like 2 hours?
Have you tried turning
like
it off and on?
Nothing happened.
Sodamelier's and what the fuck is wrong with these?
Have you tried turning it off and on again?
I tried unplugging it and plugging it in multiple times.
Yes, I
tried.
Do that.
I tried changing the USB port in the back of the computer. I tried uninstalling it from my computer and then reinstalling it. I don't think it actually fucking uninstalled it, Windows. I told it to uninstall the device, but I don't think it did.
And you can find me at Matt Hagg.
I fucking hate Windows. I'm sorry. I type in the search bar now for devices, device manager, and it just is like Google search device manager. Take me to the fucking device manager, you piece of shit. There's no... apparently, device manager doesn't exist in Windows anymore. So, I'm just out of fucking... I can't do anything. I mean, where's the fucking device manager?
Matt, play us off.
And everyone's like, it's your privacy settings! And I have it set up correctly. That's every single... My microphone stopped working. Just check your privacy settings. It's working.
Hold Windows key and press R.
You can find episodes
type
of our
control
podcast over at...
And press enter.
Over at boredintheeighties.net. Go over there and join our Discord.
Click view devices and printers.
You've been listening to the rantings of John Danger. He's at John_Danger over...
I don't
even want to
talk anymore.
I know, that's why I'm taking care
my
of it.
My fucking microphone just stopped working in the middle of talking.
Hey,
you know, this thing sounds good, but at least this motherfucker never broke in the middle of a fucking call. Sorry.
Yes. I'm TJ May. I'm at May of May 84 over on the Twitters. You can also watch me on Twitch and subscribe. That's twitch.tv/May of May. I'll be picking up the Jackbox Party Pack 5 so we can do some split the room, and more importantly, whatever that rap battle one is. Now I can't remember what it's called. Big City Beats or whatever.
Yeah, something
whatever.
Like that.
Yep. We'll play that maybe tomorrow.
The fuck is wrong with this thing?
Matt, where can we find you? And
you
music?
Can find me.
God, I'll kill myself.
MattHagg.com, where I will have music that you can listen to, because I have my phones at work.
Is your new track up, and is it going
to
be...
No, because I decided that all the vocals that I recorded were garbage, and I need to learn how to be a better singer and re-record everything. So that'll be up eventually. I don't know. How long does it take to learn how to sing? Probably like a couple of weeks or something.
I could give you backup vocals. I don't want... I'm not going to overshadow you, but I'm glad to help.
I've never sung professionally in my life.
Yeah.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Hasta lasagna.
Well, I don't have any way to record my fucking voice.
Plosives. Singles and dating. Let's get a couple up just to see if I can get something interesting. Alright, there's three of them. I'll make one of those work. Let me go get a beverage.
Okay. Let me
switch to studio, save, check my sound settings, make sure my microphone's set right. Levels looks good to me. Whenever you can, Matt, just give me the old rights to moderate.
All right.
Want to give me the audio controls, Matt?
Fine.
Do you want? Yeah. Check this out on the cam. You can see the way I have this sitting on my arm. Matt, look at. It's just directly on the little pin.
That's pretty great.
It's not really ideal. I'd like to have a shock mount, but it doesn't fit my shock mount because it just has the whatever female connector standard size. Oh, so okay. I need it's like the little one. Where is this? This has the big one on the outside. For the pop filter, which is nice. It's one of the things I really hate about the Yeti is that it doesn't have like standard, but this one at least has the standard small mount thing.
It's probably a really great and expensive proprietary.
Oh, I'm sure someone's made one that'll work, so I'll just look into that. But like the audio quality out of these is so good that it's like I can't not have one.
Mm-hmm. Sounds great.
It does sound a lot better than my other one did. It's because I have a gain control knob. And so I turned the gain way down and the volume up, and now I'm not popping like crazy.
Yeah.
It's really nice. Anyway, I was going to turn TJ
down. And it doesn't sound hissy or anything. Usually you'll get that if you try to boost the signal.
I mean, I don't know if it makes sense, like... This mic is fucking huge, though. Like, compared to my hand, like, is a fucking huge mic.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, really thick and big, like, compared to my other guy. Like, look at that. No, it's like a bit. This is like a baby compared to that thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, there's a lot of... It's heavy, too. There's a lot of stuff in there. So, I mean, it's obviously worth $120 they are typically, so to get one and fall at 76 for $100 is a pretty good deal. So, I jumped. All right, TJ, you're on studio if you can, but you can't, so you're on voice. And Matt, yep. You're on studio.
I should be on studio.
I am too.
Like I'm on studio.
It does sound like you are, and I just need to listen to the old dealy dal. I can look at my analytics.
Let me find a homework story.
Oh, I'm gonna stick with this one that I had last week. Still seems better. That's something else I was thinking about. Oh yeah. Both my beverages are in view of the camera, kind of.
Product placement.
I wasn't trying to.
Cool. Alright, let me know when you're going on YouTube so I can check the audio.
Oh, we've been on.
Oh, we're on the YouTube.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hopefully you didn't say anything terrible.
I did.
We're also on the Twitch.
I was just saying the N-word over and over and over again.
Oh, so
you're...
just like usual conversation. Then.
Yeah.
It says it's waiting for Byte Industries on YouTube.
YouTube always screws that up.
Oh, wait. Now here's the live. Alright. Alright, so let's do levels here. Okay, here's John at the distance from the mic and the volume I'll be talking at. And Matt?
Hey, I'm Matt. How are you?
And TJ?
Pleasure yourself, pleasure your friends, pleasure everyone. It's all great.
Pleasurable.
It's all pleasurable. It's all lovely.
All right. I think that sounds good. Let me just listen so everyone's silencio for just a minute.
No, I don't want to.
If you were both way quieter than me, I did fuck with some shit, so I can change it.
Wow, we actually sound really good, like leveled.
Okay, cool.
Really good. This new mic is so amazing.
Nice.
It just sounds good. Like it's got a good tone. I have it set to the... Matt, which one of these little symbols should I have it set to?
The one that looks like a heart? Like
yep,
a fat heart?
Yep, that's
what
I got set to. Because I got the option of heart.
Circle.
Marriage circles. Where there's two like overlapping, just one big circle, and then like two hearts butted up against each other. So I think it can do two people talking like this. I think.
Yeah, that's like.
And they
bipolar.
Can do a whole room.
Yeah.
And then there's two that look like they're the same.
That's interesting. You could do like bipolar with like a card art.
Maybe
pattern.
It's a mix of like whole room and side back to back. So. I don't know.
Yeah, that's weird.
Anyway, I have it set to the right one, so. And it comes with a stand that I didn't use. This guy.
Oh, nice.
It's actually really hefty. Like, you could totally kill someone with this.
Please don't, though.
I won't.
Okay, good.
Now that I have the mic, I don't need to kill.
This is all being recorded.
I immediately took it off.
I hope so.
All right. Well, let me get. Let me get ready to jack in.
Jack all in right. And jack off.
Excuse me.
Here, let me get that.
I knocked my. All right, I'm gonna try it again. Fucking thing on. All right. Let's get these over the top. There we go.
Oh, beautiful.
Holy fucking shit! I can't see a thing. I can see a blur on the screen. There's a TJ colored blur.
Hi.
So, how do I like, look? Can you see my eyes? Like really huge?
Oh no, that's
oh,
like
wait,
Gear
I know
VR.
Is.
You look like Bubbles, but from the future.
Alright, wait. Let me take the glasses off. That might
I kind
help.
Of have one of those. They're buried. It's buried in my bedroom. Oh. I wonder if my new right. phone case will help with that.
Okay. I could turn Gear VR on, though. Oh my god!
I posted on Twitter and in a couple
stupid
different...
Stupid head thing goes exactly where my headphone goes.
I will retweet your tweet.
Okay.
This is not allowing me to focus... Oh, I can see my hands, though.
I'll go ahead and do it here, too. I posted in a couple Discords.
Alright, here we go. It's making
Christ,
me sick.
I just like seeing the word kerfuffles.
Anyway, I got that out again because I wanted to fuck around with it. This because my phone randomly updated the Oculus software, and I was like, oh yeah, I have that. My phone cannot handle VR anymore, so it overheats. It says phone is too hot. Cool down.
Too hot for Twitch.
Too hot for TV.
That's the only things I watch in VR anyway.
I'm so thirsty.
Well, at least on the phone.
I've got a delicious... mix of ginger ale and cran apple juice.
Oh, I have a ginger ale cranberry downstairs.
I have
a bunch of cans of it.
It's ginger ale and cran and ocean spray cran apple, and I like to call cran apple crapple.
Yeah, so do I. I've been doing that for years. It's been great.
It's the best way. Otherwise, do we have the dock open? I think we're ready to go.
I've got the dock open. I put some stuff in there.
Oh, you put some stuff in the dock.
Not a lot, but a little bit.
Docking.
I've now added more to my soft drink reviews because I have a bunch I want to review.
Nice. Well, I'm excited.
Because Matt in the pre-show had also said, is there a new Christmas Mountain Dew? There is now a new Christmas Mountain Dew.
Yeah. Is it red and green together to make grayish brown?
They've done that in the past where it's really just regular Mountain Dew and we'll talk about it later.
They need to do it with red and green but have them be like two different densities so they don't mix together. Or do it like the Drano bottle where there's like a plastic divider down the middle.
Oh yeah,
There's some Irish coffee liqueur that's that. It's like cream on one side and like a coffee flavored liqueur on the other side. But they have two different viscosities. Jesus Christ, John.
Sorry, I saw some anime news.
What? Fine, tell us when, in the podcast.
Neon Genesis Evangelion.
I ate a Karate Kid says topic question mark. Well, as you can clearly see from the title of this video, we're going to be doing some ASMR.
Are we? I hope
no,
so.
No, that's just my clickbait.
Oh.
Topic.
Guys, I'm choosing.
I had Karate Kid's back. We haven't seen him, what, it's been a month? A couple weeks?
Yeah, where the fuck have you been?
Hey!
Jerk. Oh, wait, let me put up the starting soon thing. There we go.
We gotta start.
I haven't found my homework yet.
Okay.
You could find it during the show. You'll have it uploaded.
That's true. You're not listening to me anyway.
Oh, yeah, I don't
want
do
my
that.
Sub refunded.
Burn!
We don't have subs on this channel. Matt doesn't stream enough to get the to get the sub button yet.
Yeah.
No, I gotta sell.
Well, we've got
DVDs.
Subs. It's just a different kind of sub, if you know what I mean.
Subway.
I was just talking about this the other day. We gotta start.
Welcome to Born in the 80s. I'm John.